When talking about space, people think of the greatest achievements of humanity of the 20th century. The first man in space, Yuri Gagarin, Soyuz, the International Space Station, the moon race, all these things have pretty much marked what space has been over the last 60 years. And what about space today? We have more than 4,000 satellites orbiting Earth. We have commercial services like the Global Navigation Satellite System that allows us to locate ourselves and objects on the planet anywhere. We have TV broadcasting, we have Earth imagery. All these things have been traditionally developed with satellites that are multi-million dollar endeavors, they're typically funded by governments, and they require several years of development. This has been changing. The landscape of space has been changing, especially over the last 5 to 6 years. Look at this chart, for example. We have more than 50 startup companies being founded every year with private money. We have private investors pouring in money into those ventures because they see a commercial profit opportunity. And many of those are actually based on CubeSats, which cost a fraction of what traditional satellites used to cost. And also, all these companies operate with a very different mindset. Traditionally, the space industry has been very conservative and risk-averse. All these companies today, they can afford to be more risk-taking and actually be more ambitious in the speed in which they develop their own systems. We refer to all these things today as new space. There is no clear and well-defined definition of new space today. It's a mixture of things. It's a bit about all these small satellites, it's a bit about all the services, and it's a bit about the mindset, all of this together. And people are still arguing, debating what new space really means. What are examples of new space projects? Well, for example, today we have commercial Earth observation constellations that are able to take imagery at a very high rate on a daily basis, and these are used for business analytic purposes. We have private companies that are developing constellations for telecommunications, for internet broadcasting, and as well as for connectivity of the so-called Internet of Things, or all these millions of devices that need to be connected at a global scale. And overall, we have more than 2,600 alive startup companies operating in this sector. So this is pretty much a very big phenomenon of which speed has been increasing exponentially, I would say. So there is really a million-dollar question. Where is new space going with all of this? Well, let's have a look at a simplified view of the space industry, let's say the value chain. At the beginning, at the first, on the upstream, you have the launch segment. You have rockets, launch vehicles. Then you have, of course, the satellites. You have instrumentation on those satellites collecting data, which is then sent to the ground and received by ground stations. Then this raw data is processed and distributed to the users, and it goes to the user segment itself. And these are the people who have the needs and need answers. Now, if you think about it, the very first three, launch segment, space segment, and ground segment, these are, after all, enablers to answer the needs of the users, right? So typically what we see in new space is that money is at the user end. So this is where private money is, right? It's about a global scale customer base. So it's a much broader customer base than what the space industry has been traditionally operating. That's where the opportunity is, and that's what startups are pursuing. And no chance, it's not random that all these startups, many of them are operating downstream, right? Even those that are operating satellites, CubeSats, they're usually to generate useful data that can then be used by private individuals or companies. How is this landscape changing then? Well, the space economy operates at about $344 billion a year, US, and it's good part of it is based on TV broadcasting. This is changing. For example, ask your kids how many of them watch TV today. Well, many of them actually don't, right? Because they watch internet, they're on YouTube all the time, streaming and so on. So really this is gonna have a reflection as well on the space industry because we're moving towards data more than pure, let's say, passive TV broadcasting. And what about Earth imagery? Well, a traditional Earth observation satellites, they're passive collectors of data. So they're just collecting images and sending them to the ground. In the future, we're going to have smarter machines that can actually do forecasting, and they can have in-orbit decision-making and artificial intelligence. And as well, the overall performance of the systems is going to increase dramatically. Why? Because in order to enable those commercial applications, we need to move at human scale. Humans move at minute hour scale, whereas the images that we get today from space usually are at the best at the daily resolution. This is going to require, first of all, an investment in those constellations to get more and more data at a more frequent time pace, as well as interoperability with other sources of data, such as drones, for example. And of course, if you want to have many of these breakthroughs, which go through, for example, the ability to have autonomous spacecraft, we're going to need some new breakthrough telecommunication capabilities that are able to really realize internet in space. And speaking about telecommunications, as said, the business is going to move in new space from TV to data and all the instances of data. So we have broadband, we have Internet of Things, which is kind of a different customer, and so on. And we have to realize that all these services will scale up with the growth of the population. So we have to carefully look at the demographics on Earth to understand how the services are going to be needed and therefore used. One of the major barriers of entry here is obviously launch. Launches to space are expensive, and this is the biggest barrier to entry. So what's the main message here? Well, those companies that have a vertical integration, for example, SpaceX, that you know having launch and having satellites and so on, well, of course, they have a competitive edge on others. And we have to think about it when we design, when we launch new companies, right? What is the role of existing actors? Well, for sure, for example, space agency, what they could do is to actually reduce that barrier to entry. Okay, so those government actors should be encouraged, and as well they should have their own ambition to reduce launch costs by a factor of 10 or even 100. I would like to launch a satellite with 10,000 euro if I could. What is the role of these large traditional big companies, large integrators? Well, be ready here, because there are startups that are working hard to make breakthroughs, and really those integrators should watch at them and actually consider whether to integrate them into the core business or not, because there is potentially technology disruptions coming ahead. And what is the role of startups at the end? Well, their role is really to make money. So it's really about creating new services and disrupting ways of working, disrupting products and disrupting services. So creating something new that doesn't exist today. Where should we go in space? Well, think about it. For example, when you use electric appliances, you don't need an electrical engineering degree when you're actually plugging an appliance on the wall, right? Even though the infrastructure that is needed to make the service operate is quite complex. However, today in space, in order to use space data, you need to have specialized expertise. It's not easy at all. So what is the key for innovation? Where is new space going? Where it should go? Well, it should really make space pervasive, easy to use, operating at a human scale, and being able to scale globally. This is what would really make new space services. So again, transparency to the user, okay, and make it easy. What could we do? What I would like to see? I would like to be able, for example, to book launches as you book flights. I would like to go on the internet, put my specifics and actually get alternatives and then book them and have them in 2 weeks notice, right? Not in a year notice. So speed and time are really playing a big role in new space, and we see this everywhere. And I would like these launches to be cheap and affordable. Why? Because if I can afford multiple launches, then I can do agile engineering. I can do increasing iterations, okay? So like in agile software development, you could apply the same principles to space hardware with increasing iterations. Today, this is not possible so much because of this huge cost of launch. What else could we do? Well, I would like to purchase CubeSat components on the internet, like you purchase any other system product for your daily life. And I would like those devices to be truly plug and play. This is not true today. So today the market is very fragmented, and it's pretty much on a custom basis. To purchase a satellite component, it takes a while. I would like this to change. I would like this to be more seamless, leaner, better integrated, flawless at the end. So really make space plug and play. What else could we do? Well, there is a lot of satellite capacity in orbit. I would like to make it easy for people to use it. So, for example, having the ability to create virtual satellite missions just by federating all this capacity out there, interconnecting satellites, for example. In my research team, we have done a lot of work in this area where we consider the space cloud and the idea of federated satellite systems, which is where this is kind of the ultimate ambition. The other thing that I would like to see is easier ability to interoperate ground segments, ground stations, in order to just use it as a service. So really use space as a service. Some of these things start to happen today. Some of them are difficult to implement because of technical considerations, but this is where we're going. Now, you may think that some of the things that I said are utopic, naive, perhaps. Some of them, maybe they're not possible so much, but we should aim at them. So we should have this, let's say, imperative to simplify, make it easier, make it cheaper at the end. Make space transparent to the user and easy. We should make space as easy as switching on a light bulb at the end. Thank you very much.